Now, I'm going to take you to Sunday morning, praise and worship, old school style. Can I get some help in the house? All right. Anybody remember these kind of songs? See, I got a few on this side that already picked it up. Play it again.
You'll turn with me to the book of Psalms, chapter 69. I want to begin reading in verse 1. I have a lengthy reading. I will read down through verse 21. But I, if you will allow me, will read from the New English Translation, simply because it's a little clearer for us to see and understand. It begins in the New English Translation. It says, "For the music director, according to the tune of lilies, by David. Deliver me, O God, for the water has reached my neck. I seek into the deep mire where there is no solid ground. I am in deep water, and the current overpowers me. I'm exhausted from shouting for help. My throat is sore. Mine eyes grow tired of looking for my God. Those who hate me without cause are more numerous than the hairs of my head. Those that want to destroy me, mine enemies for no reason, outnumber me. They make me repay what I did not steal. O God, you are aware of my foolish sins. My guilt is not hidden from you. Let none who rely on you be disgraced because of me. O sovereign Lord and King, let none of who seek you be ashamed because of me, O God of Israel. For I suffer humiliation for your sake and am thoroughly disgraced. My own brothers treat me like a stranger. They act as if I were a foreigner. Certainly, zeal for your house consumes me. I endure the insults of those who insult you. I wept and refrained from eating food, which causes others to insult me. I wear sackcloth, and they ridicule me. Those who sit at the city gate gossip about me. Drunkards mock me in their souls. O Lord, may you hear my prayer and be favorably disposed to me. O God, because of your great love, answer me with your faithful deliverance. Rescue me from the mud. Don't let me sink. Deliver me from those who hate me from the deep water. Don't let the current overpower me. Don't let the deep swallow me up. Don't let the pit devour me. Answer me, O Lord, for your loyal love is good. Because of your great compassion, turn toward me. Do not ignore your servant, for I am in trouble. Answer me right away. Come near me and redeem me. Because of mine enemies, rescue me. You know how I am insulted, humiliated, and disgraced. You can see all mine enemies. Their insults are painful and make me lose heart. I look for sympathy, but receive none. For comforters, but find none. They put bitter poison into my food, and to quench my thirst, they gave me vinegar to drink." What an incredibly sad psalm. And I want to speak to you today about family effects. The Lord bless you. You may be seated. Summer before last, I was speaking in the country of Brazil. They were having a minister's conference, and I had been invited to speak. And I was the day speaker, and it was 4 days. I think my sessions were 3 hours before lunch, 3 hours after lunch for 4 days. And we did have a little break in between. And so we've been teaching, and I believe it was the second day that we were there. We were eating lunch, and that was the day I was introduced to this delicacy that they revere so greatly called lizard tail. It's not bad when you learn how to eat it, but that's the day I got to enjoy that wonderful dish. And we were eating lunch, and the young man who was the interpreter for us came and sat down beside me. His name is Daniel. And we were eating, and he said, "Brother Hughes, I want to ask you a question." He said, "I've been studying the life of David, and I found a passage of scripture in Book of Chronicles that I don't understand." And so he opened his Bible and he read it to me, the reference is to Joab's mother and her sisters, and it refers to the fact that they are the daughter of Naash. And when you read that, you know, you really, if you're not really paying attention, you don't even think about it. But Joab's mother was David's sister. So if Joab's mother, who was David's sister, had a husband with a different name, then is David really Jesse's son? Or is he the son of some other man that Jesse is going to raise? And I said, "Daniel, I have absolutely no clue. I've read that scripture all my life and never put the details together, because I never even thought about that when he's referring to Joab. I didn't connect David, and that's his mother that is being talked about." So I said, I don't know, Daniel. I'll tell you what. When I get back to my room this afternoon, I'll see what I can find. I've got a lot of my books on my computer, so I'll go back to my room and I'll try to do some research and find out what kind of information I can find. So I went to my hotel that afternoon after that evening service. We had about 3 hours before the night service, and I started trying to do research, and I read and read, and I have probably 27 commentaries that are on my computer, and I usually don't use them, but they're there, and so I went to all of them, and I couldn't find anybody that could agree on anything. Nobody knew. So I went back to church that night and said, "Hey, I don't have a clue. I can't find anyone who can agree. Don't know. I'll tell you what I'll do. When I get back to America, I will try to find an answer. And if you'll send me your email," and I gave him mine, I'll see what I can find, and I'll send you the information. So I got back to America and got busy and didn't have time to study and try to find answers. And so one day the Lord kind of convicted me that I'd give this young man the promise that I'd try to find an answer, and I hadn't done it, so I started studying, and I researched and couldn't find an answer. Spent probably a month doing research whenever I had an opportunity. Still couldn't find an answer. So one day in the month of October of that year, a year ago, I thought, you know, maybe the Jews might have something to say about this. I wonder if it might be a good idea to find out what their version is. And so instead of reading Christians, we think we own that book, but most of it's not ours. So I decided maybe it might be a good idea to find out what they think about all of this. And so I started going to the Jewish commentaries, and writings of the Jewish rabbi, the Midrashim, the Torah, to discover a story about David that I had never heard or heard anyone even talk about. David has a wonderful mother by the name of Netzebet. David's father is considered to be one of the most righteous men who ever lived. According to the Jews, there were only four men in their history that died simply because of the curse of Adam, not because of their lifestyle. One was Enoch, and Jesse is one of the others. Jesse, according to the Jews, is the chief of the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin resided in Bethlehem. And Jesse is the chief justice of their Supreme Court. It is his responsibility to interpret the law. It's his responsibility to settle arguments between families that have anything to do with the law of Moses. And Jesse is a very, very righteous man according to Jewish history and Jewish tradition. But Jesse has a blemish in his life. Jesse is the grandson of a Moabite. And the law said, you can't marry Moabites. Now, in the day of his grandfather Boaz, and Boaz was also an influential man and apparently was part of that Sanhedrin as well, that in the time of Boaz, this discussion had came up, and the Sanhedrin and the sages, the rabbis had talked about this law and came to an interpretation of that law that God did not forbid the marrying of the females of the Moabites, but of the males of the Moabites. It was the males of Moab that would not give them food or water or allow them to pass through the land. And when God gave the law, it was in reference to men and not women. And so that had been decided. And so when Ruth comes back to the land with her mother-in-law, Naomi, and starts working in the field of Boaz, and that relationship starts, and Boaz marries this beautiful young lady from the country of Moab that has become a convert. She's a proselyte. She has converted to Judaism and loved this relationship she had discovered with God, and loved it so much that she ingrained in not only her children but her grandchildren the importance of studying the law and knowing the law and knowing who God was and loving God. So she marries this man called Boaz, and the night of the wedding or the day following the wedding, Boaz dies suddenly of some disease, possibly a heart attack. But Ruth is now expecting a child. And when it's apparent she is with child, people begin to murmur. And there are those that are pointing fingers and saying, see, we knew they misinterpreted that law because God has passed his judgment on this family. And because Boaz married a Moabite, this proves that God did not favor this marriage. So Ruth brings this little boy into the world who has no father. And she has to spend her life making sure that he connects with the God of his people, and that he doesn't allow people's words or their behavior to affect his lifestyle. So this Ovid that's born to Ruth begins to grow and loves the law, loves God, loves their relationship with God. You have to remember, during this time, they're without a place of worship because Eli's sons took the ark into battle and lost the ark to the Philistines. And when the ark is taken by the Philistines in that battle, Philistines then marched to Shiloh, where the tabernacle was erected, and burned it to the ground. So from that day till this, they had no place of worship. They had an ark which was stored at someone's house. They could talk about what God had done, but there was no place of worship that they had had before. So they spend their time talking about and rehearsing what they remembered about the beauty of that place and how God moved there, and the experiences they had that became their history, their tradition, but they had no experience of going to the tabernacle to enjoy the presence of the Lord. Ovid becomes an adult, marries, has this young child that's name is Jesheb. We call him Jesse. And Jesse begins to develop into adulthood, has the same love for the law that his father has, and so begins to spend his time in studying the law, and not only just studying the law, but letting it become a part of his life, to the point that he was so consumed with the law, or the books of the Bible, the five books of the Bible that were in existence at that time, that he could almost quote them because he knew them by heart. He knew all their details. His love for God caused him. They didn't have written words like we have. They memorized the word. And so he had committed it to memory. He understood the plan of God and God's salvation. All these laws he understood. They become his life, and he poured himself into it and become so proficient in it that he rose rapidly into the Sanhedrin, and it wasn't long before he became the chief of the Sanhedrin. He gave the most wise decisions of anyone there, and they all revered him. Somebody got a decision they didn't like, and in their anger that Jesse hadn't sided with them but sided against them, they start attacking his lineage and start saying that, Jesse, you have no right to be sitting on this Sanhedrin because you're not truly a Jew. Now, that wasn't true. His father may not have been, but if he was born of a Jewish woman, who his mother was, then he's truly a Jew. Because according to the Jew, you are not truly a Jew unless you come through the womb of a Jewish woman. And so his wife was truly a Jew. So Jesse truly was. But there's this constant harassment and constant digging that you don't have a right to sit on the Sanhedrin. You're a half-breed. There's in your lineage, this Moabite that God says we're not supposed to participate with or have in our lives, and that's your grandmother, so you have no right to pass these judgments. And apparently, it became such a problem that Jesse is so consumed with doing what's right, so he makes a decision. It wouldn't be right for my children to come into this world and be harassed by all this all their life. So I am deciding I'll have no more children. And he put his wife away and made a decision that he would live celibate for the rest of his life. So they divorce. She lives at the same house, but she's just not his wife. She takes care of the children. She runs the home. But Jesse and Netzebet have no more relationships. As Jesse gets older, he gets consumed with this desire to have a child that can truly say that they are a Jew. If he's not a legitimate Jew, but he's a proselyte, then the only way to produce a child that is truly Jewish is for him to marry a proselyte. And if two proselytes marry, and they have children, then according to their law, that child is instantly a Jew. So Jesse goes to the servant of his wife, Netzebet, and says to her, a Canaanite, that if I free you and let you become a free person, and then you become a proselyte, and I marry you, if we have children, that child will truly be a Jew. So will you do that? And she agreed. But as the wedding day approached, her conscience began to bother her. So she goes to Netzebet and tells Netzebet that this is what's happening, and I don't feel comfortable in doing this. And so Netzebet and this servant make a decision that on the wedding night, they will switch places. And instead of the servant going into Jesse, she will go into Jesse. And that's what happened. Child is conceived. Now, the family thinks that she's been separated, and so she's no longer in Jesse's life. And so as the child grows and it's obvious she's with child, the boys decide that she's committed adultery, and they go to their father and tell their father, our mother is going to have a child, and I know it's not yours, so that means she's committed adultery, and the law says she must be stoned. And Jesse, being the chief of the Sanhedrin, says, no, we can't do that because the law says stone both of them, and we have no clue who the male is, so we can't stone her because we'd violate the law. So here's what's going to happen. When this child is born, this child will be treated with total disrespect. It will not even be treated as a servant. It will be treated worse than a servant. It will never be allowed to be part of the family. It will not be allowed to be involved in family activities. It will always take its meal somewhere else. It will always live on the outside, and it will have no interaction. We will not love it. We will not touch it. We will not have anything to do with it. So this boy is born. He's redheaded and apparently a beautiful child. And a mother has to raise this little boy, knowing that this little boy will never be accepted by anybody in his life, that he will always be made fun of. As he gets older, he's going to have to pay back stuff he didn't steal, according to this psalm. As he gets older, he's going to become the song of drunkards in Bethlehem, as they talk about and sing about him and his mother and how shameful she is. And he'll be the talk of those who sit at the gate. He's going to be the word of everybody's mouth as they talk about this child and how much disrespect this woman had for Jesse, that she would do such a horrible thing to embarrass him and shame him. So this little boy is raised. Now, mother has two choices. She can either teach him that he's going to have to defend for himself and just make his own way in life, or she can teach him that you never listen to what they say. You're not a mistake. You're God's child. And when nobody will accept you, God will. So don't turn to people. Don't get even. Don't act like them. Don't behave like them. When they mistreat you, don't return the behavior that they're putting on you to them. Be kind, be gentle. And so this mother keeps teaching this little boy over and over again, don't respond. Don't let their behavior affect you. So instead of teaching him to be a sociopath, it's what your world says kids growing up in that environment will be. The child that grows up that nobody loves and nobody will have anything to do with and nobody will touch, that child will be a sociopath or a psychopath. But this mother said, not my kid. I'm going to teach him how to love God. And so this little boy learned how to play a harp and a flute. He learned how to sing. He learned how to write music. He learned how to connect to God. I often wondered what God saw in David to call him a man after my own heart. When I read this story and discovered this story, then I understood. David was not a man after God's own heart because he had an ability to repent. David was a man after God's own heart because he knew God was his only hope. He knew that God was the only one who could help him, that nobody in life was going to be on his side. Nobody was going to comfort him. Nobody was going to give him sympathy. He had never found anybody that would help him. They'd put poison in his food and vinegar in his water. Nobody's ever going to be on his side. But he said, you know what? I'm not going to let people affect my connection to God. I can't exist in this world, but I can tell you what I can do. I can connect to God. And when I connect to God, I can change my world because I can live in God's world. So this little boy out in a desert, in a wilderness, discovers that the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd. Taking care of sheep. Now, can you imagine what that little boy felt like? Becoming responsible for things that would never be his. Those sheep would never benefit him. And the people that they belonged to and the people that they would benefit hate him. They hate him so much that they want him dead. So every time they hear where the lions are or the bears are, that's where they tell him to take the sheep. When the message comes through town that lions are roaming this part of the wilderness, they send David with these sheep there, hoping that a wild animal would kill him. Because if a wild animal killed him, that would mean God would remove this stigma off of their lives, and they would be justified because God would honor them and vindicate them by getting this horrible sin out of their life. So let's send him where bears are at. Let's send him where lions are at so that lions and bears can wreck his life. Can you imagine growing up in a world where people wanted you dead? Our world says that there's no hope for those kind of people. They can't become anything good. See, your world's lying to you. That's how they control you. See, your world's trying to tell you that it's all this stuff you grow up with that's going to confine or determine your life. But that's a lie. I don't care where you come from. I don't care your horror stories. It makes no difference. If you ever connect to God, that stuff's going to go away. You won't be controlled by it. You won't be defined by it. It will not determine anything about your life. It's just a roadmap of how you got here. It is not a prediction of who you are or a prophecy of what you'll become. So this little boy discovers, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. When no one would put their arms around him, he discovered, I'll look into the hills whence cometh my strength. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. He discovered the house of God wasn't that tabernacle that they were all looking for. He discovered the house of God was anywhere he was at, where he would just connect to God, where he'd just say, you know what, I'm going to worship God right here. Because he would define in that psalm about shepherds that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leads me beside the still waters. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me through the paths of righteousness for his namesake. Yea, though I walk through the valley where the lions roam and the bears, the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because you're there, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. See, God's who I need to turn to. I don't need to turn to people. I don't need to turn to anybody else. If I can ever learn how to turn to God when trouble shows up, my life changes. Because it's God who has the power to get me out. People don't. People can't change things. People are going to wreck my life if I turn to them. But God will never do that. He won't embarrass you. He won't shame you. He won't humiliate you. He will bless your life and make your life totally different whenever you learn to connect to Him. He prepares a table before me back in Bethlehem in a palace. Is that where it happens? God prepares a table before me in the presence of my... See, David discovered that God would feed him when everybody was harassing him. That God would prepare a table. God would say, time out, my son needs a little bit of refreshing. Just stand right there, devil, and watch while I minister to my kid. Stand and observe how I treat my children. Just stand and observe how I'm going to interact with those that I love. And so David would begin to understand this love of God, that His tender mercies and His loving kindness are from everlasting to everlasting. There is no end to what God would do for us. The Lord tells the prophet, get up, go to Bethlehem. I need you to anoint a king. And the prophet said, no, I can't do that. No. If I go to Bethlehem and anoint a king, and Saul hears it, I'm dead. The Lord says, no, go anoint a king. So Samuel shows up. The Sanhedrin's terrified. They think he's coming to pass judgment. Jesse and his children are horrified because they're convinced he has come to expose their sin and all the shame in their life. He's come to expose it. Can I point out to you today that God has never exposed your sin to anybody? God doesn't make a public spectacle out of you. God doesn't let those things. He doesn't put me on public display and say, look what God, what James has done. He often stands in front of me and protects me so that it doesn't happen. God's not out to get anybody. God's trying to save us. He's trying to change our lives. David understood that. And David knew that this was the God he served. And the God he served allowed him to fail without embarrassment. He allowed him to make mistakes. He didn't expect him to be perfect. What made him a man after his heart was the fact that he knew God was his only hope, that God was his resource, that God was his comforter, that God was the one that would change his life. So when the prophet arrives and he's had this celebration, he says, Jesse, where are your children? I want you to bring them. And so the Lord says, all right, it's time to anoint a king, Samuel. And Samuel has those seven boys stand up, and he looks at the oldest, who is tall, and he is good to look at, and he apparently that's got to be what God sent me. That has to be his choice. And God said, no, you're looking at the package, and that package looks real good, but I'm looking at the heart. And this one has an uncontrollable temper, which excludes him from kingship. He gets angry real easy. He flies off at people. That's not kingship material. You better be careful, because your anger can take you out of a kingship role in God's kingdom. You better learn how to control it, because it excluded Eliab from kingship. Next. So Samuel says to Jesse, he doesn't ask, is there another son? Because if he had asked if there's another son, Jesse would have said no. What he asked is there another lad? And when he says, is there another lad? Jesse's response is, a small one. Where is he? Out in the field. Where's he at, Jesse? He's with the lions and the bears. That statement had to have ate at Jesse and brought such incredible condemnation, because he knew where he'd sent that boy, and he knew what that boy was dealing with. Lions, bears. Go get him. We will not sit down till he arrives. So they send for David hours away. Someone finally finds him and brings him home. When he arrives, instead of going to the banquet, he went home to clean up. He didn't want to disrespect the prophet. He knew the prophet was there, and he knew the prophet had sent for him. So he didn't want to disrespect the prophet. So he went home to change his clothes and to clean himself. And so when he arrives, his mother hears him come in. She questioned, "What are you doing home, David? You know your dad would be angry at you if you've left those sheep alone. Who's watching the sheep?" "Well, they sent for me, mother." "Who sent for you?" "Samuel did." She says, "Oh, God's day has come." David had no clue what she's talking about, but vindication has come. And so David cleans, goes. When he walks in, he's of ruddy complexion. That means he's a warrior. But he's not just a warrior. When you look in his eyes are gentle, and he's easy to look at because he's kind and humble. And when he walked in, Samuel, that told them, "We're not going to sit down until God's anointed arrives, has sat down. And the Lord has to tell Samuel, "Get up. Your king is standing in your presence. Anoint him now." And when Samuel arises and he takes his horn of oil and David kneels at his feet, their history says that when he unplugged that horn of oil, that it was like it was pressurized. It just started bubbling out as if the oil wanted to get onto the head of David before Samuel could even start pouring. And as he starts anointing David with this oil, this horn will not empty. The more he pours, it just keeps flowing. And it keeps flowing, and it now covers his head. It's run down his garments. It's puddled around him. And as he's totally saturated with this anointing, all of a sudden, that oil begins to solidify, and the oil forms a golden crown on his head. And when mother saw it, she stepped into that place and she said, "What you have discarded, God has now made the cornerstone. What you don't know is this is his son, and you treated him with such disrespect, but God today has vindicated him because of who he is, not what you've done." You see, the struggles of life, all those bears and lions you fight, they have a purpose. Because when you get through the struggle, there is an anointing waiting for you that will give you such an ability to affect life. It will be beyond your imagination. When he pours that oil out, it's like it wants to get on you, and it'll start bubbling and overflowing because God's desiring to anoint your life for his purpose, because he desires to bless you. I understand that probably some of you have heard things like, "I hate you. I wish you weren't born. You can't do anything right. You're stupid. You're dumb. You're not lovable." I know some of you have heard things that cut deeply, and you found no one to sympathize. There was no one to give comfort, no one to hold you or touch you. But God says, "I'll hold you. I'll touch you. I don't care what the world does. I don't care what people do. You may have had to live among some lions and bears, but I promise you, if you'll just acknowledge that I'm your cleft of the rock you run into, I'm your high tower." Most of the Psalms that David wrote, he wrote before he was anointed king. The Lord is my shepherd. I will lift mine eyes unto the hills from which cometh my strength. There is none like him. There is none like him. See, he will be my rock, my strength. He is my glory and the lifter of my head. He reaches down. He'll get off his throne. He'll walk down to where I am. When I confess and I fall in his presence and I say, I'm not worthy, he'll crumb off his throne and step down and put his hand under my forehead, and he'll lift me up and he'll look in my eyes and he'll say, I've anointed your life for a purpose. And it doesn't care how many lions and bears you've had to fight, or it doesn't matter that there might have been a Bathsheba or some other horrible thing in life. It doesn't matter, because I've got anointing on your life. If you learn how to connect back to me. See, a person who's truly connected to God is never afraid to confess when confronted about their life. See, when he was connected to God, when Nathaniel shows up, the prophet says, there's a story about a man who had a sheep, and someone took it, and David was angry. He said, you're the man, David. And he repented, put on sackcloth and ashes, repented for what he had done. Because when God came, he always responded, because he knew that he was comfortable in God's presence, and God would never abuse him, hurt him, humiliate him, or destroy him. He was always looking out for his good. I don't know why some of you think God's out to get you, but he's not. If God wanted to get even, trust me, folk, God could get even. God's not trying to wreck your life. He's trying to bless your life. But if you don't get your eyes off of this world and what this world's doing, get your eyes on this world, you're going to miss your anointing. The cornerstone, what you have disrespected, or what you've thrown away and made trash of, he's made the cornerstone. See, David's life parallels Jesus closer than any other person in the Old Testament, and his mother parallels Mary closer than anyone else in history. What's God have for your life today? Are you going to let life rob you of the greatest treasures you could possibly have? Because you get locked up with the junk, thinking about the junk and reliving it. Are you going to discover, you know what? I got to turn to God. And when I turn to God, according to David, he will make me white as snow. I'll delight myself in the Lord, for he shall give me the desires of my heart. He will help my heart change when I put my trust in him. See, there's none like him. He's not out to harm you today. He's out to bless you. Please stand.
Not a second or another minute. Not an hour or another day. But at this moment, with my arms out, I need you to make a way, as you have done so many times before. Through a window or an open door, I stretch my hands to thee. Come rescue me, I need you right away. I need you. Another minute. not an hour of another day, but Lord, I need you right away. If I never needed you before to show up and restore all of the faith that I left slip while I was yet searching the world for more, the truest friend I have indeed. You're my best friend I know in need. I stretch my hands to thee. Come rescue me. I need you right away. The agony of being alone, fear of doing things on my own, the tests and trials that come to make me strong, the feelings of guilt, hurt, shame, and defeat, the ways of trials that beat upon me. But to know, Lord, that in you I've got victory. I need you now. Not another minute, Lord. Can't wait another day, oh.